SENS Foundation has a lot of projects that we work on all at the same time. There are three projects that we're working on at our research center in California, and then there are a whole bunch of others that we support at university laboratories around the world, mostly in the USA. In the research center in Mountain View, California, the three projects that we're working on are, first of all, mitochondrial mutations. We're interested in combating the accumulation of mitochondrial mutations, not actually by repairing them, but by making them harmless, by putting modified copies of the mitochondrial genes into the nuclear DNA, modified in such a way that the proteins go back to the right place, even though the DNA is in the wrong place. This is an idea that was actually pioneered in Australia by a group in the Monash University, about 25 or 27 years ago even, but has actually been very, very challenging to make work in general. However, in the last few years, a number of breakthroughs have been made that have made the whole thing much more realistic, and we're pursuing that with a lot of energy now. The second thing we're working on at the research centre is to identify enzymes from the environment, especially from bacteria, that can break down substances whose accumulation in the body over life causes diseases like cardiovascular disease and macular degeneration. We've become pretty good at finding enzymes that break down these substances, and now we're developing ways to put them into mammalian cells in a manner that actually allows those cells to survive longer. We just published in the April of 2012 the first demonstration of rescue of cells from toxic substances that accumulate in the body using a system of this nature. The third thing we're doing at the research center is part of our cancer project. We're interested in combating cancer by controlling the elongation of the ends of chromosomes, these things called telomeres, and we're working specifically on a rather neglected area in that field called ALT, alternative lengthening of telomeres, which is a method that about 10% of cancers use, but it's still very poorly characterized genetically, and we're working on that. The elimination of this junk that accumulates inside cells using enzymes from bacteria is what we call medical bioremediation. We call it that because bioremediation is the use of very much the same method to eliminate pollutants from the environment as a method of environmental decontamination.
In the
environment. Bioremediation works extremely well. It's not just an academic idea, it's a thriving commercial discipline. And it certainly shows us that it's pretty straightforward to find enzymes that break down more or less whatever you want, so long as the thing you want to break down is organic and rich in energy, so that if a microbe can break it down, it can live off it. Most of the work that's going on related to SENS does not directly relate to longevity, and that's because the SENS approach to combating aging is a divide-and-conquer approach, an approach in which we split the problem of aging into a number of sub-problems, and we address each of those individually. In any divide-and-conquer approach to a complex technological problem, you don't expect to see any actual result in terms of the overall goal of the technology until all the components are working at least reasonably well. And we're certainly not at that stage yet. So yes, there's masses of progress in SENS in various of the strands that we've been pursuing, but that has not translated into a longevity benefit yet in any species. However, there is plenty of work going on in simpler strategies to combat aging, strategies that we don't pursue because they won't scale. They will only give a modest benefit to postponing the diseases and disabilities of old age, but which we very much are happy that other people are pursuing because they may very well be easier to implement in human beings than the SENS approach. So, for example, a few years ago it was discovered that a drug named rapamycin was able to significantly extend the lifespan of rodents. This was quite a surprise because the drug had been around a long time. But, there's been a lot of study of how that happens ever since that time, and we may be able to turn that into a useful therapy for human beings. There's still a lot of excitement around drugs that emulate calorie restriction, that extend lifespan of rodents, especially by tricking them essentially into thinking that they are in a famine when they're not. And of course, there's a lot of work going on still in trying to evaluate other approaches to combating aging by simple methods. There's constantly new news in this area. The SENS approach is very much a divide and conquer approach. If any one of the seven approaches to combating the seven deadly things, as I like to call them, is not actually implemented, then we can realistically expect only to postpone quite modestly, maybe by only a few years, the diseases and disabilities of old age. There's only really one exception to that, which is the accumulation of mitochondrial mutations. That's an exception because at this point we still don't know really anything about the details of how mitochondrial mutations contribute to age-related ill health. There are a number of theories out there, including one that I put forward about 15 years ago, but there still is no real conclusion on that. Whereas for all the other six, we can point to one or another major age-related disease that kills people, and that is mainly driven by that particular strand. So, we basically have to do the whole job. And if we don't, until we do, we're not going to see much in terms of benefit. We will, of course, see benefit against specific diseases, and that's a very good thing, because that's how these therapies are going to, first of all, make money for the people who invest in their development and in the clinical trials, and it's also how they're going to get through regulatory approval from agencies like the US FDA, which don't regard aging as a disease. Lysosense, or lysosomal enhancement, is all about trying to get rid of the material that accumulates inside cells during life. Cells have an awful lot of different things to do in order to actually do their job, and many of the metabolic processes that they perform create byproducts. Now, in general, those byproducts are either broken down or excreted so that they don't accumulate. But very occasional products that accumulate really slowly, are often simply sequestered inside the cell, simply because evolution has not had any real need to develop a method for breaking them down or for excreting them, because people didn't get old in the wild. But now that we are all getting old, we have problems with that accumulation, just in the same way that your house doesn't work so well if you don't take the garbage out for a month. So, what we're doing about that at SENS Foundation is we're identifying bacterial species and the genes within them that allow bacteria to break down these substances. We have evidence initially that those genes, those bacteria, must exist because these substances don't accumulate in the environment, in graveyards, for example, which are, of course, enriched in human remains. And sure enough, we found it quite easy to identify such bacteria and to identify the enzymes that they have that allow them to break these things down. Now, what we're working on is putting those enzymes into mammalian cells, in cell culture, human cells, so as to actually protect those cells from these toxic substances. And we've got pretty good preliminary results in that area. In fact, they're not so preliminary anymore. The first paper reporting such results was published by one of our groups about a month or two ago in April of 2012. So we're really getting there now. Now, of course, there's still a long way to go. We've got to make the same thing work in actual living organisms in mice, and only then can we start thinking about clinical trials. But it's really going in the right direction, this work. One of the seven strands of SENS is to repair the type of damage that we call simply cell loss. In other words, cells dying and not being automatically replaced by the division and differentiation of other cells. And that is the area of SENS which is familiar to the general public and to the medical profession in general, because the way to fix it is simply stem cell therapy. Stem cell therapy is all about putting back cells that the body has not put back on its own, typically by introducing cells which are not the missing type of cell themselves, but which can divide and transform into the type of cell that has gone missing. This is something that, of course, has applications way beyond aging. many, many applications for example, repairing spinal cord damage, things like that. But it certainly has applications in aging. The example that's most easy to explain is Parkinson's disease, which is caused by the loss of a particular type of brain cell, a particular type of neuron in an area named the substantia nigra. All of us lose cells in that particular area of the brain a lot faster than any other area. But some people lose those cells faster than others, and the ones who lose them most rapidly are, of course, the ones who get Parkinson's disease. So there are therapies for Parkinson's disease already, but they don't work very well. Ultimately, the reason they don't work very well is because Parkinson's disease, like anything age-related, is progressive. It gets worse and worse, and so therapies that involve just, for example, putting back the chemical dopamine that these neurons, these missing neurons, are supposed to make, it becomes increasingly ineffective. The only way that can be really considered likely to be a real cure for Parkinson's disease is stem cell therapy. And sure enough, people are trying that, and it's doing okay. The stem cell therapies for Parkinson's disease are already in clinical trials. Those clinical trials are at an early stage, and a lot of those trials haven't worked, I have to admit. But that's how things are in science. Einstein said, if we knew what we were doing, it wouldn't be called research. And some of those trials are working. When this therapy works, it works spectacularly well. So it's just a matter of time before it works spectacularly well reliably. We at SENS Foundation support very little in the area of stem cell research. And the reason we don't do much is simply because a lot of other people are doing it. Pretty much every area of stem cell research that's relevant to aging is being pursued quite aggressively by other people around the world, independently of us, and of course independently of our funding. And that means that we can focus our funding elsewhere. There's really only one other area that's getting enough attention that we can afford to neglect it, and that is the elimination of molecular garbage outside cells, specifically in the brain. People have been interested in this problem for quite a while because the accumulation of what's called senile plaques is a key feature of Alzheimer's disease. And these are extracellular garbage, molecular garbage outside the cell. And it was found some time ago, about 13 years ago now, in 1999, in mice, that if you vaccinate against this material, then it goes away because the immune system of the brain, cells called microglia, engulf the material and break it down internally. And this has moved quite rapidly into clinical trials, and those clinical trials have gone pretty well, so that they're actually already in phase 3, which is the last stage before regulatory approval. That means that, of course, a lot of people are putting money into it, and there's absolutely no need for us to do so. However, I want to be clear that it's not just a case of we focus on this strand and we don't focus on that strand. In the case of extracellular garbage, we actually are funding a project in Houston at the University of Texas and also in Harvard. And we're doing that because other types of extracellular garbage, other than in the brain and made of different materials, are not being pursued in this way by other people. Not enough, anyway, not nearly enough. And so we are able to make a difference, to actually speed things up, by working in an area that is ostensibly very similar to something that is being well-funded. I think that actually the prospects for extended longevity in the next 10 or even 20 years are pretty slim. I think that the rate of postponement of age-related ill health and the rate of consequent increase in longevity that we've seen since World War II, which is about 2 years per decade in the Western world, is quite likely to slow down and to plateau over the next 10 or 20 years. The reason I say that is because I think that the reasons why that increase has happened in the first place are reaching diminishing returns. Those reasons are things like prenatal nutrition having improved during the first few decades of the 20th century. Things like smoking having progressively declined in many countries in the Western world. And things like the sheer amount of hard labour, the amount of seriously strenuous manual labour that people have to do, having gone down as manufacturing has given way to service industries so much. All of these things have contributed to people just staying younger for longer, as well as, of course, advances in medicine. And advances in medicine will continue, but those other things, probably have run their course to a very large extent, and therefore they will not be able to contribute so much to a continued increase in longevity and in healthy longevity. However, of course, when regenerative medicine against aging really starts to kick into gear, we will see a very strong reversal of that deceleration, a very strong acceleration to a speed of postponement that's much faster than 2 years per decade, and which I think will reach 10 years per decade pretty quickly, and that, of course, is longevity escape velocity. I would love if we could find a way, a simple way, to really, really bring cancer under control. As things stand, our progress in postponing age-related cancers, which is, of course, most cancers, has been considerably less than our progress in postponing cardiovascular disease. The result is that more and more people are dying of cancer and fewer of cardiovascular disease, and actually cancer is almost catching up with cardiovascular disease as the number one killer in the Western world. So we've got a serious problem there. Now, the thing about cancer is that, standing back and looking at the overall question of those, the whole range of age-related diseases, cancer stands out as probably the hardest one of all to fix, simply because it has natural selection on its side. Every cell in a cancer, that's a trillion cells in a clinically relevant cancer, is, you know, a furnace of genetic creativity. It's trying to mutate. It's very genetically unstable. It's trying to find new ways to survive. And so killing a cancer is incredibly hard. I think that we still have a chance, especially with various approaches to immunotherapy for cancer, stimulating and potentiating the immune system against cancer. There are some really exciting projects going on that may translate into what you might call magic bullets for cancer. But I certainly don't want to bet on it. And that's why SENS Foundation is focusing on a very elaborate, very multi-component approach to combating cancer, which pretty much everyone agrees will work, will really, really work if we can implement it. But a lot of people are rather pessimistic about whether we ever could implement it because it's so elaborate.